Hachette Audio presents Cold Barrel Zero, written by Matthew Quirk, read by Peter Coleman. For my father, Commander R. Gregory Quirk, United States Navy, retired. Reveille, reveille, reveille. They would come for him at night, so Hayes was awake. He finished with his codes and laid his Bible on a makeshift table, a plank set across two splintering crates. He never really slept anymore, just rested for a few hours during the day, lying dressed on the floor on top of a thin blanket. He brushed a mosquito from his arm where a patch of rough scar showed under the sleeve of his t-shirt. Once it had been a tattoo, a combat diver in jump wings, the seal of the 1st Force Reconnaissance Marines. But 2 years ago, he'd had to take it off. A sparrow perched on the branch of a tree outside. As Hayes watched it, his thoughts drifted back to the dead. It flew off. Another bird followed, then a dozen more. The rustle of wings surrounded the hut as hundreds of them rose, filled the sky, and blotted out the stars. Hayes stood, slung his rifle over his shoulder, grabbed his bag, and sprinted through the door of his compound, leaving the light on behind him. He stopped after 75 meters, danger close range for the hellfires, and ducked behind the trunk of a Miru oak. He could have gone farther, but he needed cover between him and the sky. Drones are silent, despite all the myths locals like to believe about death buzzing over their heads. If the machines allow themselves to be heard, it's a show of intimidation. When they come to kill, they stay high and make no noise. Hellfires move faster than sound, so the target dies unaware that he has been hit. He knew it was futile, but he scanned the sky anyway. The odds of catching a reflection from the sensor ball were almost nil. A hare bolted across the savanna. Above him, a sparrow returned, looking at him hiding behind the tree, and cocked its head. "I know," Hayes said, and took a deep breath. Too long running, too long alone. The paranoia was getting to him. He'd been speaking a mix of Egyptian Arabic and French with a Belgian accent for the last month, passing himself off as a mineral engineer. He needed to get across the border. The rest of the flock settled. He relieved himself against the tree, then started back toward the house. 3 seconds later, a sonic boom punched him in the stomach and ears. It felt like a small, close explosion. The shockwave from the blast knocked him back on his heels. Flames licked red through the rising cloud of black smoke. As the debris showered down, he threw himself behind a tree and waited a moment for the disorientation to pass. He stayed there until the smoke expanded enough to cover him from above, then ducked low and stepped through the wreckage toward his truck, an ancient Land Rover Defender. Strong winds blew from the east. The smoke would lift in a few seconds, and the drone would see him with its infrared cameras. He'd run the drill himself dozens of times, calling in strikes with an infrared laser. The drone would circle back and then clean up the squirters with its second missile. A smoldering piece of plywood lay on the ground beside him, a foot from the waist-high grass that surrounded the compound. He needed cover. The fire might work, or it might kill him. There was no time to think twice. He kicked the wood into the brush. White smoke twined up and joined the last black fumes from the demolished house. He stepped into the truck. The natural instinct was to speed from the blast, from the eyes above, but he waited, calm. The wind caught the embers, and the grass became a wall of fire rushing toward him. He started the engine, but didn't move. Only when the flames reached the rear bumper did he touch the throttle and begin to roll along slowly, keeping a few feet ahead of the blaze roaring behind him. The heat wavered in the air in his mirrors. The curtain of smoke and heat would conceal everything the Predator had, visual and IR. He would be safe as long as he stayed cradled in the fire. It grew, faster now, and he just outpaced it, bucking at 20, 30, 40 miles an hour over the rutted tracks through the grasslands, moving with the flames toward the wooded foothills and highlands beyond. The fire jumped ahead. He checked the speedometer. Any faster, and he would break an axle. The rear window blew out from the heat. The forest was close. It would give him cover. There were too many ways in and out to find him. The fire leaped ahead and swallowed the truck. He pressed the pedal to the floor. He had to get through to warn the others, The hunt had begun. Chapter 1. Moray yawned as she walked past the only grocery store in town, a Chinese-run market. Dust caked her skin. She had been in the highlands for 3 days and nights. She spent most of her time hunting, both to feed herself and to cover her expenses with guide work, trophies, and bounties. A pool of brown, foul water filled half the square. She circled around it. She left her dog, a boxer mutt, in the passenger seat of the truck with the window cracked and headed for a storefront off the main path. She came every week. Fax and ADSL were hand-painted on the window below Arabic script. She pulled her headscarf forward, looked away from the security camera, and took a terminal in the far back. She opened up the browser and went to Hotmail. She double-checked the date, the 12th of October, 12:10 in military format. From her shoulder bag, she pulled out a small volume with a cloth cover over the original leather. It was a Bible, the most common book in the world, the King James Version. They were using a book cipher based on the date. The 12th, she counted off 12 books, which brought her to the second book of Kings. October, she went down 10 chapters. And finally, she used the last two digits of the current year to count down verses. Her finger rested on the page. And he said, "Take them alive," and they took them alive, and slew them at the pit of the shearing house, even 42 men. Neither left he any of them. She took the first letters of the first 10 words and typed them in as her username, ahstttatt@hotmail.com. Then she proceeded to the next verse and used the number and the first 10 letters as her password. 15AWHWDTHLOJ. She had done this every Sunday for the past 2 years, and every Sunday, she had found nothing. She was starting to hate this ritual. It felt like rolling over in the morning and reaching for a spouse long dead. Each account was used only once. She clicked on the spam folder and skimmed the page. There wasn't much because of the randomness of the username. Then she saw it. The fourth message down. She thought at first it must be a mistake, but no. It was what she had been waiting for. It read like any other prescription pill come on, but for 2 years, she had been waiting to see this sender's name, John Okoye, 27. She clicked on the email. "Best and cheapest Premier Pharmacy," the text read. What interested her was the embedded JPEG file at the bottom of the screen. It showed a blue diamond-shaped pill. The colors looked normal to the naked eye, but the pixel data had been manipulated, with extra bits written over the least significant color codes. Photos modified with this embedding technique, called steganography, appeared as normal file attachments. An encrypted message wouldn't be able to withstand the NSA's deciphering tools, and encryption would only draw attention to it. That was why Moray's instructions masqueraded as spam, hiding in plain sight. Just one more drop in the sea of garbage coursing through the web. She downloaded an open source program from the internet and extracted the message embedded in the photo. It was a sequence of 14 letters and numbers, which she broke into grid zone designator, 100,000 meter square ID, and positioned north and east, down to the meter. They were MGRS coordinates, the military's version of latitude and longitude. She memorized them, then took a disk from her bag and inserted it in the computer. It spun and began wiping the machine's hard drive. She returned to her truck, a rusting Toyota Hilux. She kept everything she owned in it. A battered Pelican case behind the seats contained an MK-11 Mod Zero sniper rifle, a night scope, and a suppressor. She'd removed the passenger airbag to make room for a hidden compartment, known as a trap. The only way to open it was to press down both window buttons and the hazard lights for 3 seconds. Inside there was $90,000 in U.S. currency, 5 passports, and a 1911 pistol with no serial number. The boxer cocked his head at her. She opened the door and let him out of the car. She ran her hand over his head a few times, then climbed back in and drove off. In the rear view, she watched the dog fall back, sprinting after her through the mud, disappearing slowly in the distance. 7,500 miles away, a screwdriver rested on the open pages of Speed's Bible. Electronics and machinery spilled their insides over every horizontal surface of his one-bedroom house. It hadn't taken long for word to spread through the peninsula about his ability to fix anything. The pocket watch in his hands had been a labor of love. He'd carefully tweezed apart the workings, even milled a new balance staff. He had been planning to drop it off at the apartment above the billiards hall on his way out of town.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.